Hi everyone, welcome back to Spiritual Growth Tarot. I'm Denise, and today I'm going to do a couple of astrology readings on Donald John Trump. I have his solar return right here, which will show us what's in store for him for this year, for this birthday coming up. And then I have his transits to his natal chart. So, you know, some of those will be very long-term transits. So solar return, transits. I looked at his progressed chart, and I didn't see anything major, so I figured, why waste time on that? But, so for those of you who enjoy astrology, these readings will be for you, and for others who maybe want to learn, I'll be very simple. And others who don't like astrology at all, well, you know, you can look at my other videos on him. We'll be able to figure it out, no matter which way. Okay, so let me drop the camera down and I'll get started. Okay, so first chart, we're just going to look at for a minute or two, because I wanted to show the beginning of the eclipse season. So it started December 14th, 2020, you can see here. And this is the start of his challenging transits, because we've got this lineup. It was a new moon solar eclipse, and it landed right on his south node, you know, past life point, karma that we bring in, one of the aspects of karma, and his moon, which would be, of course, you know, his public persona, public reputation. And the fourth house here is, you know, like our emotional foundation. It's a foundation of our life that we can spring forward from and move out, you know, into the other areas of our lives. So his emotional foundation is tied very much to his family. Very, very much to his family. You can see that. Or any astrologer can see that very clearly. Now, his north node is in his 10th house of public reputation, career, purpose, you know, and his sun and Uranus are right there. So, you know, we will always see him as somebody who is surprising and shocking. And now, I would never say this about any Gemini, but for him, it's duplicity and lying and just living in such an entrenchment of duality that he can't really see the forest for the trees. Now, the outer wheel, so the inner wheel is his natal chart, and the outer wheel here are the transits that were happening during the 2020 new moon solar eclipse. So, you know, the planets are moving, right? And while the natal chart stays stationary, just for the purpose of, you know, delineation, I guess you would call it, you know, for looking at it. Now, transiting Neptune at that date was squaring his sun Uranus, north node, and then squaring also down here his moon and south node. So in his situation, now the higher octave of Neptune would be spiritual relationships, being that the seventh house is about relationships. It would be reaching out to be with, you know, kindred spirits that that you care about, you know, if you're evolved, but he's not. So we have to go to the lower octave of Neptune, which is just deception and delusion, confusion, not seeing things clearly at all. And of course, he would attract those types of relationships because, you know, under the law of affinity, like attracts like. So whatever we're emanating from within, whether we're conscious of it or not, is what we attract. So also, I'm not going to pay too much attention to this right now in the eighth house because I'm going to cover it in another chart. But we can see Uranus up here in the ninth house of courts of law and politics, you know, foreign cultures, publishing, media, all different types of things, higher mind, but, you know, not with him. With him, these are the two keywords I'm focusing on. And I wrote all these little notes, so if you want to, you know, screenshot anything, I'll keep the chopstick away. And you can screenshot it just so you can see what's going on. But clearly with Uranus up there in the ninth house, and Uranus stays in one house for 7 years, we could see, and this is why I easily could see that he was not going to win, because Uranus creates big changes. Now, the only way that it does, well, it's always going to create big changes, but the only way that you like the changes is if you're working consciously, and he was not. So that's the reason that I could see that he was one of the main reasons. Plus, it showed up last year in his solar return, you know, for that year. Okay, so now, next thing we're going to look at is the solar eclipse. Let me move this up so you can see all my little notes. I hope you can see them. I have to screenshot this and then scroll in, but I'll speak to the, probably should have written that in black, I'm sorry. But I'll say it out loud. Okay, so what we have going on here is the solar eclipse that's coming up on the 10th. Today's the 5th, June 5th, 2021. And we have aspects to Saturn and Pluto, which I've created a little note up here. Saturn to Pluto aspects create pain and loss. And even if you're working in the light, it's still not going to be easy. And we can all just think back to 2020, you know, the whole year of 2020 and going through, well, in 2020, it was a really tight orb. Let's see if I, well, no, this one would have, no, actually here's how I can tell you. See right here, these were the transits on December 14th, 2020. This is before, you know, we had the inkling of the coronavirus coming to the USA. And we can see right here, Saturn, Jupiter, and Pluto are all together. Or wait, or was it the 20? Shoot, I can't remember. Oh my goodness, I can't remember when the, I think it was 2020. 2020 was the year from hell. But I was trying to remember, like, did we have the coronavirus in 2019? No, it was 2020. I'm losing my mind there. So anyway, Saturn and Pluto, even if you're working in the light, it will still be challenging. It will still be challenging. And for him, he's working in so much darkness that he's so in denial of, so unconscious of, that he's definitely challenged that way. And here's where we can see right here. So Saturn right here, this is the focus here. Saturn's here in his 11th house. And, you know, the 11th house is your goals, your wishes, your hopes and dreams and your friends and group consciousness. And with him, you know, all this focus in Cancer, this is why he, you know, jumped on board with his father who liked to be a builder, because, you know, Cancer often rules real estate. But anyway, to stick with the opposition we have going on here, notice how Saturn's at 23 degrees Cancer, and Pluto is at 26 degrees Cancer, or I'm sorry, Capricorn, so that's an opposition. It's only 3 degrees away. And we're in a Pluto, you know, like retrograde right now. So what kicked this whole thing off? It's, you know, he's got Pluto, Saturn here, like his natal Pluto, transiting Saturn, I should say, is, my goodness, he's got this double whammy. Transiting Saturn is opposing his natal Pluto, and with the retrogradation process there, it started March 16th this year. And it's going to last all the way through December 13th, 2021. And some of the key dates, To watch for, and it could be like a week before, a week after, you know, on either side of these dates. Major problems on May 23rd, which we could see, you know, he already had. And I think there was some announcement there about the criminal probe into him. It was went from civil to criminal. And there's many cases there. There's several cases going on there. You know, bank fraud, insurance fraud, tax fraud, and others. And then another one of the key dates to watch for is August 3rd, 2021. Now, Saturn being in the sixth house of health, that's not easy. It's challenging. It's a time when a person would focus to use the energy and consciousness in the best way, is you would use that time, and it's been there for at least a year, and it's probably got about a year and a half, because it takes 2.5 years to get through one house. You would use the energy and consciousness of Saturn in the right way by, you know, getting systems working really well in your home, work, and day-to-day details. And then also in, you know, health. You would make sure you're eating right. This would be, Saturn takes almost 30 years to get all the way around the chart, 27 to 30 years all the way to get around. So if you live to be 90, it's only going to make it around the chart 3 times. Well, he's definitely gone well beyond his second Saturn return. And this transit of Saturn in his sixth house of health, I don't think is going to be very good for him or fun for him. And with it being in Aquarius is, you know, I mean, Aquarius rules the ankles, but it's also so connected to Uranus that, you know, this could be like his electro, you know, his, well, not more than his electromagnetic field. I'm thinking neurology. I'm thinking, you know, like your body's electrical system. So there's challenges there. And then Saturn is square Uranus, where we all are having this transit here, Saturn square Uranus. And this is where, you know, we're needing safety. Uranus in Taurus can bring in the element of inventions to create safety, innovation and inventions to, Uranus rules the internet and our electrical grid, power grids, what else? Anything that rules electricity and anything that rules being online. It's also the planet of invention and innovation. And then Taurus is all about security and safety. So here we are having cyber attacks. You know, here we have the planet that is that rules Aquarius, and then we have Saturn in Aquarius. And Saturn is about tests. It's about mastering reality, you know, physical reality. And it's about structure. And the old, you know, you think of like Father Time, that would be Saturn. You think of, it's another, you know, it's a very karmic planet. So he's a part of this disinformation and this warfare, and he's hooked in with Putin, who is part of this in a big way all over the world. Putin has been a huge problem in cyber warfare all over the world. So, you know, messing with elections, and he's still doing it. He's still doing it. He has an opinion about the insurrection. You know, it's like, you know what, dude, keep it to yourself. We don't need to hear from you. But no, he has lots of things to say about that. And it's obvious that Trump has been using Putin's playbook to do his grifting and to do his power plays. So Pluto is here, transiting Pluto now, or has been for years, has been in his fifth house of will and creative self-expression and power. You know, it's ruled, the fifth house is ruled by the sun. So his sun in Gemini has been kind of, charged up to say the least. But Pluto It opposes his natal Venus, December 20th, so literally Christmas Day this year. And his natal Venus conjunct Saturn, this is his like millionaire, billionaire aspect. This is his ability to have money, to create money. Of course, it's related to other people in, you know, groups. It's not just him alone. If it were him alone, he'd probably have it here in the second house. But he was born into it. So that's, of course, why it's here. But to have transiting Pluto opposing natal Venus is not good. That's not good for money. That's like an explosion, you know, on one end. And the explosion will be his power and control. And it will affect his children as well, because the fifth house is all about children. So, you know, could even affect his grandchildren as well, of course. But then again, I don't know. I kind of feel like Ivanka and Jared probably have their own thing going on. But there's others. Don Jr. has 5 kids. But then again, thank you guys for all your awesome comments. I have learned from you that Don Jr.'s ex-wife is financially independent. So they're, you know, maybe those kids won't be affected. And Eric's kids, I don't know about. I think they have a couple. But anyway, Saturn going through the sixth house is not fun when it comes to health. It's when you get things together, and he's not getting anything together that way. We just know it. And on March 24th, 2024, I forgot I have some notes here for you. I'll get to that in a second. It's March 24th, 2024, that Pluto hits his sixth house, and that makes it even more difficult. I mean, you can see the grace of the transits where, like, Uranus comes through first and, you know, tries to help you make changes. And Saturn helps you. Jupiter expands things. Saturn brings in lessons to help you, you know, create things that are stable. Uranus will help you make the changes. But if you don't, the outer planets, Neptune, well, Uranus, Neptune, and Pluto, they're all outer planets. Uranus used to be, Jupiter. Jupiter used to be more of an outer planet until they, things seem to be far away until you've discovered them, basically. But anyway, the way the planets go is that, you know, Jupiter moves faster and it opens and expands things. And then Saturn comes in behind and says, okay, well, let's try this out. You know, these are the two builders of the zodiac, Jupiter and Saturn. And it helps you test your limitations. And it changes, you know, you have to make changes based on what works and what doesn't with these two. But then moving forward, Uranus comes in and will really upset the things that do not work well. And that's what's going on right now. I mean, we could just see that Uranus square Saturn for us is like, you know, the coronavirus was a big wake-up call. It has to do with, changing how we move around the world. Lots of us can stay home and work, and those things are going to be changed for probably forever in the future, where there's not all this, traveling, commuting that has to happen just to work. We can work from home. We can work from an office that's closer to our home if it has to be in an office, rather than all this ridiculous commuting. And that helps, you know, heal the planet because we're slowing down all the, you know, carbon, the greenhouse gases that way. So this is, you know, something we're all going through. And then as well as, you know, how we treat animals, how animals are slaughtered, things like that, where there's changes there. This Uranus to Saturn square, like I said, has everything to do with cyber warfare, getting some new inventions to protect us that way. And any type of like microwave technology, anything that is that could be harmful, that can be sent, you know, because now we have, of course, all the technology to send things, and I think we have for years, but to send things like far away, to send radio beams and laser beams and all of that, you know. So, but anyway, when Pluto hits his sixth house, if he's even still on the planet by then, it's not going to be easy at all. It won't be easy at all. And by then, Saturn, if he's still alive, Saturn will be up here somewhere in the seventh and eighth, and that's not going to be easy for him. These are not easy transits coming up. Not at all for him. And, you know, Pluto, you can see natally, he was born with Pluto on the 12th, and I don't know, I always have kind of a joke in my head about Pluto on the 12th. It's like, you know, either they're a saint or a psychopath. Obviously for him, he's a psychopath. And then Mars on his ascendant just is what makes him so enraged all the time. He can't seem to control his impulse to just rage. So you know, power management issues. And you can see that he has an overwhelming amount of fire and air in his chart. Fire, air. It's got a little bit of water. Do I see any grounding here? Do I see one Earth planet? No, I do not. Yeah. Fiery ascendant. He's got an earthly midheaven. That's about it. Yeah, lots of fire and air. A little bit of water, but it's just enough to make him constantly, emotionally reactive if he doesn't get what he wants. So anyway, the transit's coming up, so on June 28th, this, you know, right after the solar eclipse, I tuned into this transit here, this Venus on his Mercury and his Mars on his Venus, that's moving into the 12th, and then by the 28th, it'll hit Pluto, his natal Pluto. Mars moves pretty fast. It takes only a couple months, a month and a half to 2 months to get through one house, depending on the size of your house, but through the 12th house, it's the house of the unconscious. It can be your connection to the universe, to God, to your angels, your guides, to large, you know, like institutions where people are working in the light, but not for him. So it's just going to bring up his unconscious anger. And the little note was that I got was that he's only going to want to talk to people who agree with him. Because, I mean, that's pretty much his MO. That doesn't take any intuitive or psychic ability to know that. That's just observation with him. But that popped into my head, so I put a little note there because I think that's how it's going to play out. He's going to become more and more insular, you know, in his life. He's going to go inside more and more, which he needs to. He needs to because he, you know, he's always been so outer-oriented. Let's see. So next. Oh, the only other thing, well, no, there's two more things here with this chart. And this is also the, you know, the transits. I'm looking at all the transits on top of the solar eclipse. So this portion of the reading is, you know, takes up the most time. This Chiron and Neptune transiting through his eighth house, I feel like that's going to just bring in more of, it's him with his own self-worth issues that he needs to work on, but it also attracts delusional people with self-worth issues. So again, under that law of like attracts like, the law of affinity, you know, there you have it. Because the eighth house is the house of other people's resources. So to have Chiron and Neptune there is not good. It will be dissolving his connection with other people's resources because it's getting down further and further to the point where nobody can easily... It's moving towards forward with time. It's not going to be easy for people to donate large amounts of money to him. And that's because of the work that Biden is doing. You guys know Heather Cox Richardson. This is important. I pulled this out of her. I get her emails every night. If you guys don't, if you don't know about her, you could look her up, and I bet you would love her. Anyway, she's an American historian, and she reports on everything that has happened throughout the day. And so this was a part of the long, and I love what she writes because she includes all the links to where she gets her information, so it's easily, you know, fact-checked. But anyway, here's what she wrote the other day. Maybe it was yesterday, the day before. Oh, no, it was yesterday, June 4th. First National Security Study Memorandum of Biden's presidency was issued today, June 4th. It formally establishes the fight against corruption as a core U.S. national security interest. So the NSA is involved in this. And it begins by noting that corruption provides authoritarian leaders a means to undermine democracies worldwide. To combat that corruption, Biden vows to combat all forms of illicit finance and internationally, in the U.S. and internationally. He will robustly implement the law that requires all shell companies, I love this, to disclose who owns them. A rule in the National Defense Authorization Act that Congress passed over Trump's veto January 1st, 2021. Yeah, and she said, remember, I wrote then that this piece of law would end up being important. The memorandum promises to hold accountable, corrupt individuals, transnational criminal organizations, and their facilitators, including by seizing stolen assets. Wow. So they will be held accountable, and it will include seizing their stolen assets. The U.S. government will work with international partners to stop the strategic corruption that enabled bad actors to interfere in U.S. elections. A shot across Russia's bow. And work across offices, agencies, and departments, state, treasury, defense, justice, commerce, energy, and so on, to develop government-wide policies that will root out corruption. By effectively preventing and countering corruption and demonstrating the advantages of transparent and accountable governance, we can secure a critical advantage for the United States and other democracies, the memorandum reads. So I thought, yes, this is perfect because, you know, this is everything that Sheldon Whitehouse has been diving into as well. But looks to me like Biden has backed him up. Biden's in, you know, they're all in on it and they're working together. So that's more proof that the Democrats are working hard. Okay, so last little thing here. Pluto in Aquarius. I thought you guys might want this key date here. Pluto moves into 0 degrees Aquarius. Pluto will be out of Capricorn March 23rd, 2023, but not for too long because then it retrogrades back into Capricorn May 2nd, 2023 and stays retrograde until October 11th, 2023. It retrogrades all the way back to 27 degrees Capricorn. And then after that date, then it'll start transiting forward again. And that will be the end of that threefold phase of retrograde gradation. So it won't be until, you know, we won't really feel like we're totally in. There might be a breakthrough in March of that year, 2023, but we won't be fully into Pluto in Aquarius until, you know, late fall of that year or mid-fall, somewhere in there. Okay, so back to Flump. This is his solar return for 2021 to 2022. So everything I'm telling you here is in force for that entire year. It's not just for his birthday. It's not just for a couple weeks. It's for the whole year. The ascendant is what he will be attracting. Because it's in Libra, I hope it's justice coming. Libra is ruled by Venus. Venus is up here in the 10th. And it's squared by Chiron. You can see right here, Venus. And there's a square over here to Chiron in his seventh house of relationships. So there's more of that those self-worth issues. And the notes I have on that with some key dates that I think might be something may manifest is because we have to remember Venus is about his money, and in the 10th house it would be his control issues tied to his self-worth because it squares Chiron over here. And his self-worth is, you know, that's one of the major things about the narcissistic personality disorder. Yes, they're very, very, very selfish. And yes, they live lifetimes of betrayal, self-betrayal, and they betray others because that, you know, they're just in those dynamics constantly. But deep, deep, deep down inside, they have a deep loss of self. They don't really know who they are. So they're completely dependent on the outer world to mirror back to them how they're doing. And that's why they explode. And that's why they exact revenge. You know, so that's pretty much what's, you know, what's happening with him and a lot of the GOP members. So anyway, you know, these control issues that are tied to his self-worth because his self-worth is not found within himself, it's found outside himself. And the key dates I have here are July 18th to the 24th, August 15th to the 28th, September 2nd to the 12th, and then September 17th to the 21st, when there are flare-ups with all of these aspects that I'm going to talk about. So, with Venus in conjunct this 150-degree aspect here, Saturn, remember Venus and Saturn has to do with his money. Well, Saturn in the fifth house for this year, this birthday, I feel he's going to suffer a loss of, you know, fame. I mean, I would never call him a famous person just because he had The Apprentice and, you know, he's become more famous because of, I don't know, I always considered him like a B-rate actor, if even that, not even, maybe C. But he's become more famous just because he's become president. But, you know, what kind of an idiot with his dirt runs for president? It's managed to blow everything up. You know, he might have skated under the radar with all this, you know, bank fraud, insurance fraud, and tax fraud that's coming down on him. But no, he had to push. He had to push because that's who he is. He's a bully that pushes. So I see this as being a loss of fame for him. Jupiter's there also in conjunct. Now, this in conjunct aspect here to Venus is the loss of fame and loss of money, loss of a reputation as lost his reputation as to his ability to earn money. And with Jupiter in conjunct over here to the Moon and Mars, Jupiter expands. So it's going to blow up his self-will, but it's going to be kind of dissipating because it's in Pisces. It's meant to connect to spirituality, but that's not him. So what we have here is this explosion. So the way I see it is that, and especially on June 17th, there could be some explosive rage that comes through for him that he, you know, way that he either explodes or implodes. Because honestly, that's how energy works, you know, energy and consciousness in our bodies. If we're not headed towards the light, at some point our energy magnetics within just start working against ourselves and start creating health issues. So I don't know. I've always seen him either having a heart attack or a stroke, if not both. So anyway, Moon trine Neptune, I think, just can bring in emotional health issues. Even though trine's an easy aspect, there's still a connection here. Neptune in the sixth is not easy either. It's, you know, when we have those transits or have it for the year in our you know, soul return, what we need to do is look to alternative medicine and spiritual healing. But if he has a health issue, usually it can be like kind of hard to diagnose, but I don't know if that'll be the case for him because he has such good medical care. He might be different. I think he would be different that way. But Neptune squaring all of these planets up here, and remember, ninth house is courts of law and politics. And so there's this disillusion of his health based on all the stress of the court cases. Mercury brings in messages, so we could look at Mercury bringing in all these documents of, into the court. Or the courts already have them, but they would be presented through the court. The attorneys, I would say, Cy Vance Jr., Audrey Strauss, and Letitia James, and Judge Amy Berman, they all have the documents already, but they would be presented in court. But of course, it's all, closed doors, behind secret. But then again, another way to look at it is, I just hit on this, I didn't think of it before, Mercury could be bringing in all these witnesses that will testify and flip, because Gemini duplicity type of energy, sometimes it flips. And this would be all the people who are granted immunity, who testify. They're automatically granted immunity. So there's that. Thank goodness. Oh, man. Okay, so Uranus in the eighth house, again, like I've said before, Uranus is big, sudden changes. In Taurus, it has to do with money, personal finances, ability to earn. And so big changes in other people's money, and resources, their ability to help them. I think there'll be big changes there. And again, you can see the Saturn square Uranus, transit that we all have. This all shows up somewhere in our charts. For him, in his solar return, this is that big challenge to his, position and his ability to create, new ways to escape. And it squares over here to the eighth house of other people's money and resources. So the other thing that's really important, most important in a solar return chart, is where the sun lands. And again, up here, he's going to be in court all year long. Or if he doesn't show up, there will be court cases coming down against him all year long. Now, with Pluto here in the fourth house, and it's opposing his moon and Mars up here, this adds to that explosive rage that could come through him. Pluto in the fourth is hell, unless you're remodeling a house or building a new house. Pluto going through the fourth house by transit's harder because it lasts longer. For solar return, it just lasts for that year. But it would be, it's hell if you're not working on yourself. It's awesome if you are, because it helps you transform yourself quickly. Helps you get through a lot of emotional baggage and transform yourself, especially in relationship with family members. But that's not him, The younger brother that he bullied all his life, especially growing up, Robert, he's crossed over. And his other brother, Fred Jr., of course, died years ago. Does he have a deep family relationship with people who really love him, or are they just afraid of him? And are they going to be some of the people that are showing up and flipping in court? I think so. Because they've all been deposed and they all have to go in and they have, many of them already have. Eric and Ivanka already have. I don't know about Don Jr., but I think so. Anyway, this, to me, is going to be an emotional reckoning for him. And big changes at home. Big changes to his, like I said before, fourth house's foundation, emotional foundation, family foundation, literally the foundation of your life. Imagine you go to work and then you come home and it's your sanctuary. But if the planet of hell... The planet of the hell realm is in your home. Oh my God. Okay, so I think that's about all I want to say with his solar return. I think that's it. What else do I have? Oh yeah, I did his secondary progressions. There, when you run a secondary progress chart, so the way that works is that we have to remember here, he was born with 22 degrees Gemini Sun, and the sun progresses 1 degree a year, so he's now progressed to a 4 degree Virgo. So it makes him a little more paranoid, I think, in his case. Virgo can be very healing and discerning, but not in his case. He's paranoid. We know he's paranoid. And Mercury has progressed. With the progressions, you don't do the slower moving planets or the outer planets. You just do the personal planets like the Sun, Moon, Mars, and Mercury, Venus. And you pay attention to the hot points, the ascendant, descendant, midheaven and the IC. But the only thing I see there is that he has a 0 degree, his ascendant has now progressed to 0 degrees Scorpio. So it's all about revenge for him. The ability to go deep and transform, but I don't think he's headed in that direction because he doesn't seem to be wired that way. He's completely off his path. So anyway, with Mercury, so Pluto's been sitting here. We have to look at his natal Pluto. Let's see, natal Pluto. I'm sorry. What am I looking at? Solar return there. Natal Pluto, see how 10 degrees right here, 10 degrees Leo. It's only progressed 2 degrees, and he's 75. So you can see how slow Pluto would progress, so you don't even really pay any attention to it. But Mercury has been going, progressing around, and it's gone over his Pluto. And this is why all these years he's had this opportunity to transform the way he communicates. Pluto transform Mercury thinking and communication and networking, bringing in information, dispersing information. All he's been doing has been lying. So he now, reputation, 10th house reputation, he has a reputation as a pathological liar. So the other planets, moons in Virgo, another aspect about progress to Virgo, another paranoid aspect there in his case. Wouldn't say that about anyone else, but in his case. I might say it about someone else who who's like him. Yeah, and then all these other planets are just kind of sitting here in his 12th house of the unconscious, you know. Again, here's more of that opportunity for him to look to himself for his self-worth rather than relationship, but he doesn't do that. He's unconscious that way. So that's all I have there. I do have other videos I'm going to do on him, such as looking at if he's going to, you guys had questions about, is he going to try to take off to another country? And is Ivana any way connected to all this with him? There were a few other questions I can't remember, but I'll put those in a separate video because not everybody wants to watch astrology. Okay. I'll be back later. Hope you guys are doing well. Happy weekend. Bye.